To invite you again this morning to join us in Romans chapter 8. Actually, we'll be discussing some matters that pertain to what we've discovered so far in Romans chapter 8. But let's make our way through, pick it up from where we left off last week. And remember, last week we were looking at being led by the Spirit in some areas. Let's just jump right in this morning. You know, if you were to travel around the world today, you would find that there is what we could call an ancient religious practice taking place that has never ceased to exist. In fact, we can be confident it's being practiced somewhere in every area of the globe, even at this very moment. It takes on many different forms. Every major library in this country, at least, contains a half dozen or more books concerning this topic. Many hospitals are adopting it as part of their patient recovery process, and lawsuits have even been waged over it. What is it? Prayer. Absolutely. It didn't take long for you to figure that one out, did it? No matter what you believe about it, practically everyone has done it. Some recite in unison, some listen to the leader, some one at a time, some individually, and all at the same time, some in public, some in private, some from memory, some spontaneously, some long, some short, some bow on bended knee, some fall prostrate to the ground, some bow to the east, some stand at a wall, some use beads, some use books, some pray with head covered, some pray with head uncovered, some with eyes opened, some with eyes closed. But whatever form it happens to take, prayer is universal. I'm told that more people believe in praying than believe in the existence of either heaven or hell. Now, isn't that interesting? Let me mention a couple of other interesting things I've run across in this study. In certain Eastern cultures and in some of the Eastern religions, they use what is called a prayer wheel. Have you ever heard of a prayer wheel? What they do is they write their prayer out on a little piece of paper and they tuck it into the crack on this prayer wheel. Then they give it a spin and they keep that wheel spinning time after time after time, because that keeps the prayer in circulation. You see, according to those who use prayer wheels, that prayer goes up. Every time the wheel spins around and that prayer comes to the top of the wheel, the prayer goes up. The more it spins around, the more often it goes up, according to those who believe in the prayer wheels. And the more often it goes up, the thinking goes on. The greater the probability it will make an impact on the one to whom they're praying. That's the prayer wheel. In Japan, you might see a little different approach. You might see what they call a prayer tree. Practice with prayer there, I've learned, is to tie little white rolls of paper onto the twigs of a tree using a ribbon and some twine. And, of course, each prayer request would be written on one of those little scrolls of paper. And as long as the paper remains on the tree, the thinking goes, the one praying can feel reasonably confident that his particular request is being answered. If that piece of paper should fall to the ground, fall off the twig, the applicant should rethink his request. He can either start all over again with the same request, or he can offer up a new request on a new roll of paper. So these are interesting things. A lot of different customs and rituals when it comes to the issue of praying. The best question we could ask today is this. What does Scripture have to say? What principles can we draw from the Word of God so that we who are trusting in the finished work of Christ might understand the mind of God when it comes to our communication with God? Let me just mention three principles that I see in God's Word. Now, there are many more here, but three sort of pop up. We won't do an exhaustive study. Many things could be said, but these three things pop up right away, and I believe they're important things for us to acknowledge when we consider the subject of prayer and praying. Principle number one would involve the discrete aspect of prayer. The discrete aspect of prayer. This is a principle taken from the instruction Christ gave his disciples in Matthew chapter 6. In fact, we'll glean all three principles from Matthew chapter 6. Principle number one, the discrete aspect of prayer. Let's read from Matthew chapter 6, beginning with verse 5. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray. Notice, this is interesting here, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be what? Seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. That one's pretty straightforward, isn't it? Gives us a little bit of God's mind when it comes to this issue of prayer, and especially the discrete aspect of praying. God intended that communication with him be personal and private. Discrete. Christ was saying that. This is not to say that public prayer is wrong, but Christ was issuing an obvious warning to his disciples here, and he was telling them that there is a danger involved when it comes to public prayer. The danger is simply this. Prayer can be taken from the realm of discrete and moved to the realm of display. a very real danger, not only in Christ's day, but in ours as well. Christ was warning against that. He was obviously displeased with improperly motivated prayer. Now you might ask, how can we tell the difference? How do we know when our underlying motivation for praying is correct? How can we know that our praying is not prideful, but personal? Well, I believe Christ's words are a sufficient test. What did he say? Prayer done for the benefit of being, what are the three underlined words there in verse 5? Seen by men, seen by others. Prayer done for the benefit of being seen by others is improperly motivated prayer. Anytime we are concerned that others see how we pray, or that others see when we pray, or that others see what we pray for, we can be reasonably sure that improper motivation has somehow crept its way in through the back door. When our concern is what others are taking notice of, our praying has moved out of the realm of discrete and into the realm of display. And it's most often done for the purpose of letting others know how spiritual we are. Christ didn't call that spiritual. He called that hypocritical. A logical question then would be, can public prayer be discreet? Sure it can. As long as the motivation for praying publicly is absent a concern that others are watching. Prayer straight from the heart as we express our anxieties to God, and whatever those anxieties may be, by the way, one pastor said the most beautiful prayer he had ever heard was a prayer that came from the lips of someone who had never prayed publicly before. Although it was simple in thought, incorrect in grammar, and absent all the public prayer cliches that a seasoned prayer might use, that new believer had become totally oblivious to the fact that someone else was even in the room listening in. He was expressing his heart and his mind to God, and as far as he was concerned, he might as well have been alone. Christ was saying the focus of praying should be vertical, not horizontal, not done that it may be seen of men. Praying should be discreet, not done for the purpose of display. Then we could come to a second principle here that can be gleaned from verses 7 and 8. Let me read that one. I call this the detached aspect of prayer. The detached aspect of prayer. Follow along as I read. Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 7. But when ye pray, ye use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. Praying can become mechanical. Ritualistic would be another way of saying it. The vain repetition mentioned right here in this verse. The idea behind principle number 2 is that communication with God is oftentimes nothing more than ritualistic repetition, saying the same thing over and over and over again without really giving a thought to what is actually being said. When you look up those two words, by the way, vain and repetition, the words mentioned there in verse 7, when you look those up in the thesaurus, do you know what you come up with? Empty habit, vain repetition, empty habit, an overly practiced routine, thoughtless repetition. Do you suppose any of that might be taking place today? It would probably not surprise you to know that thousands upon thousands of churchgoers will recite a prayer in unison this very morning. And although it is contained in many prayer books, most will recite it from memory. And it comes from Scripture. It's perhaps the most memorized portion of Scripture, next to John 3:16, to be found in the Bible. And I would venture a guess that most everyone here this morning knows it by heart. What am I talking about? I'm talking about prayer that has come to be known as the Lord's Prayer, which brings us to principle number 3. This one is not actually found in Matthew, but it's the third principle, the dispensational aspect of prayer. The dispensational aspect of prayer. What do we mean by dispensational prayer? Can prayer be dispensational? Well, God has made some changes in regard to prayer down through the course of time. He has dispensed information concerning prayer, and these changes have to do with different dispensational settings that must be taken into consideration. For example, week before last, we looked at some of the phenomenal promises that Christ made to his disciples in connection with their prayer life in the establishment of his earthly kingdom. There was a time during time past when believing Israel was given a taste, as Hebrews calls it, of the powers of the kingdom of heaven, a taste of the kingdom designed in the heavenlies, the kingdom that will be ultimately set up right here upon the earth with the nation of Israel reigning and ruling with the 12 apostles reigning and ruling with Christ, that kingdom promised to Israel. Of course, the kingdom we're talking about, the kingdom that was promised to Israel, has not as yet been set up, has it? By the way, we today are not ushering in that kingdom, of some have supposed. Instead, God has put that kingdom on hold. And Paul tells us that God has ushered in a brand new dispensation called the dispensation of grace. And he has dispensed through our risen Savior to the Apostle Paul some brand new information about prayer where we are concerned. But back when God gave Israel a taste of the good things to come, back when that kingdom was right around the corner, it had not yet been put on hold, Christ gave his disciples some very specific prayer promises as part of their taste of the kingdom. He revealed to them a prayer called in Scripture the prayer of faith. Now, we examined the prayer of faith a couple of weeks ago. Whatsoever they asked, believing. And you've often heard these verses, probably quoted in conjunction with prayer. Whatsoever they asked, believing, they were already received. No questions asked. Were two or three agreed on anything, it would be done. The sick would recover. The lame would walk. The blind would see. The deaf would hear. You see, the prayer of faith itself was a taste of the kingdom that had been promised to Israel. God said through the prophet Isaiah, way back in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 24, "And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear." The prayer of faith. The prayer of faith was given for a specific time. It was a taste of the kingdom in time past. The kingdom that God has promised to Israel, and the kingdom that God has put on hold. Now, during this dispensation of grace, it's important for us to understand the prayer that Paul has revealed to us, the prayer that offers peace in the midst of our conflicts, is something entirely different. But what about the prayer we mentioned earlier, the prayer that people are reciting every day throughout our land, the prayer called the Lord's Prayer? We're going to examine that this morning, so that we can come to a better understanding of what it really means and for whom this prayer was intended. But before we begin, I want to establish a couple of points about this particular way to pray. Point number one, even though we commonly call it the Lord's Prayer, and it is never called that in Scripture, by the way, we should realize that, it could better be called the Disciples' Prayer. You see, this is not a prayer that the Lord was praying. It was a prayer he was giving to his disciples when he was instructing them how to pray. The Lord's Prayer is found over in 1 John 17, verses 1 through 26. In fact, that entire chapter is the Lord's Prayer. It starts out, "These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said." Another instance of the Lord praying is found in Luke chapter 22, verse 42. When Jesus knelt down to pray in the garden, he said, "Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." These are the prayers our Lord prayed, but the one we're looking at right now is not one of these. The prayer in Matthew 6 is simply an example Christ was giving to his disciples when he was teaching them a way to pray. Point number two, Christ never intended for his disciples to repeat this prayer word for word over and over again for any and all circumstance. In fact, he explained that in verse number 9 when he said, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye." The word manner literally means in this way or like this or in this fashion. In other words, Christ was saying, this is how you should pray, after this fashion. But as we saw earlier, he never intended for them to repeat the same words over and over and over again. Christ called that vain repetition, empty habit. Overly repeated habit. Point number three, and this is the one that probably surprises most people today. Point number three, while it's a beautiful prayer, it was never meant for people living in this dispensation of grace. Now, that may surprise many of us. While it was a beautiful prayer, it was never meant for people living in this dispensation of grace. We better explain this one. It was intended for people who were going to enter the tribulation period, the 7-year period of tribulation that will be the very next thing on the prophetic calendar, now after the body of Christ has already been caught up to be with the Lord in the air. You see, there's an event to take place, an event yet to take place, and that prophetic event is called the tribulation period. We're living in a mystery period today. We're not waiting for that next event to take place on God's prophetic calendar with Israel, because we're living in a mystery period called the dispensation of grace. But there are people who are going to enter, after the body of Christ has been caught up in the air to be with the Lord, there will be people entering the tribulation period. God's people, Israel, his people for that day, the nation Israel, he'll be resuming his program with them. They'll be entering into that 7-year period of tribulation on the next prophetic event after the body of Christ has been caught up to be with the Lord. Remember, Christ's disciples were given a taste of the kingdom to come. But before that kingdom could be realized, there was a prophetic event that would have to occur. It was not the dispensation of grace. They knew nothing about the dispensation of grace because this dispensation had been kept secret. It was a mystery according to the Apostle Paul. The next event on the prophetic calendar, as far as the apostles were concerned, was the tribulation. The disciples' prayer, the way that Christ taught his disciples to pray, has special application. It was specially suited, we could say, to the tribulation period that was right upon them had God not put that program on hold. Let's examine what I would call the disciples' prayer. Let's examine it line by line. How does it begin? Matthew 6, verse 9, if you're looking there in your Bibles, Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, "After this manner, or in this fashion, therefore pray ye, and the first words, Our Father which art in heaven." Now stop there just for a moment. Today, as believers in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, we enjoy a father-child relationship with God. That's a very special relationship, but we need to understand at the time this particular way of praying was spoken and given to the disciples, Gentiles did not have that relationship with God. We were Gentiles in the flesh, and when Christ gave the words of this prayer, only the Israelites were considered the children of God. Now let's look at an example of that. It's found over in Matthew chapter 15. Remember, the Gentile woman who came to the Lord, you remember that event, and at first he wouldn't even speak to her. Some people are surprised by Christ's seeming attitude to that lady. But only when Christ saw that she recognized her place of submission under the people of Israel did he answer her request. Now notice the statement that Christ made in Matthew chapter 15, verse 26. "But he answered and said, It is not meet, or it is not fitting, to take whose bread? The children's bread. And to cast it to who? To dogs." Who were the children there? They were the children of Israel. They had a relationship with God. They were his children. He was their father. But what about the Gentiles at that time? Were they considered children? Not at all. In fact, the Lord said, "It is not right to give the children's bread to," and he used that term, "dogs." Christ was not insulting the woman, by the way. He was simply telling it like it was. The Gentiles, during time past, were not considered the children of God. And so at the time this prayer was given to pray Our Father meant that you recognized, if you were an Israelite, that you had a covenant relationship with God, that you were indeed his children if you were a Jew. And that's the only basis by which a person could say, Our Father. All the way through the Old Testament, time and time again, God said to Israel, I will be a father unto you. You will be my children. And now, as the Lord was teaching his disciples, the Jewish disciples again, how to pray, he said, pray Our Father. In other words, recognize your covenant relationship with God as you are praying. Now, if you're taking notes, you might want to jot down Ephesians 2:12, a little reference to the Gentiles here at that time. Ephesians 2, chapter 2, verse 12. "That at that time, ye," speaking of us Gentiles, "were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world." Now, the next part of the prayer, right after that part, says, "Hallowed be thy name." Now, why did Christ want them to pray, "Hallowed," or "Hallowed be thy name"? What does "hallowed" mean? "Hallowed" means holy. In fact, it comes from the same Greek word as holy. And the point Christ was making there is that the name of God is a very important aspect of God's program with Israel. Remember, the Israelites had the responsibility to make God's name known among the Gentiles. I'm going to take you to Ezekiel for a moment here, a passage there in Ezekiel. And I think you'll be amazed at how many other statements from the prophetic program correspond precisely to the disciples' prayer. You see, the Israelites had the responsibility of making God's name known among the Gentiles. So that name, making it hallowed, was a very important thing. Let's look at it. At the point in time of this passage, Israel had been disobedient to God, and she was about to be dispersed and sent into captivity. Ezekiel wrote, and as God revealed this to the prophet, Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 19, "And as I scattered them among the heathen, and they were dispersed through this countries, according to their way and according to their doings, I judged them. And when they entered unto the heathen, whither they went, they profaned my holy name, when they said to them, These are the people of the Lord, and are gone forth out of his land." Israel, profaned, God's holy name. But I had pity for mine holy name, God said, which the house of Israel had profaned among the heathen, whither they went. Every time you see holy name here in Ezekiel, you can put in hallowed name. It means the very same thing. Now notice in verse 22, therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, I do not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for what? For mine holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the heathen, whither ye went. You see, Israel was to make God's name holy among the heathen, among the nations, among the Gentiles, but they profaned God's holy name. And God said, and I will sanctify my great name, verse 23, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them, and the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord God, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. Time after time in that passage, God said, you have profaned my holy name, Israel. Look what you've done. Now, when we come to Matthew, Christ is among his disciples, and he's teaching them a special way to pray, and he's teaching them to pray, hallowed be thy name. Do you know what he was teaching them there? He was saying, get back to your program, Israel. Realize your responsibility. Do what you're supposed to be doing among the nations, among the Gentiles, and make God's name holy among all those you happen to meet. When you pray, our Father, Israel, follow it up with, hallowed be thy name. You see why Christ wanted that particular phrase in the manner of praying that he gave to his disciples? Now let me point out one other passage. Right before the book of Matthew is the book of Malachi. The prophet Malachi made a similar statement. Notice Malachi chapter 1, verse 11. For from the rising of the sun, even unto the going down of the same, now notice it here, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. Who was supposed to see to that? The nation Israel. In every place incense shall be offered, Malachi said, unto my name in a pure offering. For my name shall be great among the heathen, saith the Lord of hosts. Israel had a tremendous responsibility to make God's name known among the Gentiles and to make it hallowed or holy. That's why Christ incorporated it into the way that he was teaching his disciples to pray. To the tribulation Jew to whom this prayer will apply, when he prays, hallowed be thy name, he will be acknowledging to the world at that point in time his responsibility to make God's name known among the Gentiles or among the nations, and the fact that God's name is indeed holy. Which brings us to the next statement. Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, thy kingdom come. Now let's stop here again for a moment. Believe me, thy kingdom come will be a very heartfelt part of this prayer during the tribulation period. You see, during the tribulation, the Jews will be under tremendous persecution from the Antichrist. He'll be putting them to death for their faith. You know what they'll be praying? Thy kingdom come. Because their only hope of deliverance at that time will be the coming of the king to set up his kingdom. Thy kingdom come. The next prophetic event after the tribulation period is the millennial kingdom, when Christ comes to rule and reign over the earth. That will be the deliverance the Jews will be praying for during the tribulation. The only way of escape from the oppression they'll be experiencing during the time of Jacob's trouble will be the coming of the kingdom. They'll be praying, Lord, bring it on, thy kingdom come. Tell me, is that the deliverance that we are praying for today? Are we looking forward to the next event on Israel's prophetic calendar? Christ's coming to establish his kingdom. Is that what we are looking forward to? Or are we looking forward to the next mystery event? Christ coming in the air to catch us off this earth to be with him in the air forever. We need to understand the disciples' prayer was designed to specifically reflect Israel's hope. That's why this particular way of praying was given to them. And that's why they'll be praying, thy kingdom come, bring it on. Now, we see the next phrase, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Here is a divine definition right here of the millennial kingdom. A divine definition, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. What is the kingdom? Think about that for a moment. The kingdom is when God's will is carried out in the earth to the same degree that it will be carried out in heaven. Notice that it talks about God's will being carried out on the earth. That's particularly significant here. Why is that a significant part of this prayer for the Jews? Because the Jews have an earthly hope. They were not looking forward to being in heaven. They were promised the earth forever. We are the heavenly people of God, the body of Christ. Paul tells us that our citizenship is where? It's in heaven. But the Jews will be praying for God's will to be carried out right here on the earth to the same degree that it is being carried out at that time in heaven. Now, this is an interesting thing here. Think about this with me for a moment. The words are, "Thy will be done in earth," and notice the verb tense, "as it is in heaven." And yet, even today, is not heaven somewhat defiled? Satan still has access to heaven. Did you know that even at this very moment, Satan can come and go in the heavenly realm? His fallen angels are, in fact, in the heavenly realm right now. Not in the third heaven, of course, where God resides, but we can say that God's will is being totally done in heaven right now. Or how can we say that if Satan still has access there? How can we recognize or reconcile, rather, the words, "Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven," if Satan still has access in that realm? We have to understand that the great persecution to come upon the Jewish nation, the persecution for which they were being taught this way of praying, will come during a particular part of the tribulation period. It'll come during the second half of the tribulation period. Let's take a look at a passage in Revelation chapter 12, because something very significant happens halfway through the tribulation period. Notice it with me. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 6. "And the woman," now who is this woman? It's none other than the bride of Christ, believing Israel at that time. "The woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. A prophetic year, by the way, is 360 days. So if you do your quick math, you've got 3.5 years in this verse. Now notice verse 7 through 10. 3.5 years you're looking at. Revelation chapter 12, verse 7. "And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought against his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out," that old serpent called the devil and Satan, "which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." This is taking place here halfway through the tribulation period. "And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night." You know what you've got here? At the time when Israel will be facing the wrath of Satan, the time when Israel was being prepared for, when they were being taught how to pray, Satan will be kicked out of heaven at that time. And the Jews will be praying at that time, just as the disciples have been taught to pray, "Thy will be done in earth, just like it is being done in heaven." This prayer has special significance to the second half of the tribulation period, when Israel will be facing all the wrath that Satan can possibly muster. "Thy will be done in earth," they will be praying, "as it is in heaven." Satan will no longer have access to that realm. What comes next? Matthew chapter 6, verse 11. "Give us this day our daily bread." Now, this is a good one here. If you know your prophecy, you know that during the last half of the tribulation, the time we've been looking at, something happens that makes this part of the disciples' prayer particularly significant. Let's look at that. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1. "And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the names of blasphemy." This is actually a description here of the Antichrist. And this is happening halfway, the same time period that we're looking at, halfway through the tribulation period. A particularly interesting thing and significant thing as far as Israel will be concerned at that time. Verse 5, Revelation 13, 5. "And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue for..." ...16 and 17. "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that," now mark it, "no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." Now, if you can't buy or sell, think about that for a few moments. What are you apt to become? Why, hungry. The Jews will not be able to buy food unless they become united to the Antichrist. If they take the mark of his name, they can never be united to Christ again. So if they refuse the mark, they are bound to become hungry. What would they be praying? Think back to that way that Christ taught them to pray. Give us this very day our daily bread. Tomorrow is not the issue for us, Lord, they'll be saying. Feed us today. We'll take it one day at a time. Will the Lord answer their prayer? Why, yes, He will. And the Scripture tells us how He plans to do that in Revelation chapter 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Give us this day our daily bread. Very significant way to pray during that period of time. Well, what are they going to eat out there? Now, this is interesting. If we want to look at that, the book of Revelation tells us that as well. Revelation chapter 2, verse 17 says, He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone. And in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. Now, in case you're wondering, what is the hidden manna mentioned here in verse 17? The hidden manna, the daily bread that Israel will be praying for. Manna is what God fed Israel in the wilderness. You recall that. And Scripture refers to manna as the food of angels. Isn't that an interesting statement there? The food of angels. God will supernaturally provide Israel's nourishment during that time of the tribulation, because she will not be able to buy food short of taking the mark of the beast. Give us this day our daily bread. Those people will be praying. Do you think the disciples' prayer will be very meaningful at that point in time? Well, absolutely it will. Now, I want to show you a contrast. The Jews will be praying for the special provision of their daily bread. Notice what Paul has to say to the believers in Thessalonica. And the same applies today, by the way, because we're speaking of the dispensation of grace when we talk about the Apostle Paul. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. For even when we were with you, Paul said, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat. And again, down in verse 12, 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 12. Now them that are such we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness they work and eat. Does it say angels' food there? No, and eat their own bread. Let's move on to the next part of the prayer. Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. I can almost guarantee you, if those who recite this prayer as a prayer for today understood what this statement is saying, they would probably not recite it again in those same words. You see, what it's really saying here is forgive us in the same way. Forgive us our debts in the same way, or our trespasses, in the same way or to the same extent that we forgive others. Tell me, do you want God to forgive you to the same extent that you are willing to forgive others? Most of us would be in pretty serious trouble if that were the case, because we don't always forgive that well. But this prayer fits in precisely with what Christ taught the kingdom believers. Notice on down in verse 14, Matthew 6, 14. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, then what? Neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. That, by the way, folks, is law, not grace. Today, we're not forgiven on the basis of whether or not we forgive. And we're not forgiven to the extent that we forgive. We're forgiven on the basis of the shed blood of Christ, and that alone, and our faith in that. The finished work of Christ has accomplished our forgiveness. Total forgiveness for total sin, for the sum total of all eternity. And it's all past tense. Is that not amazing? It's up to us to either accept it or reject it. Simple as that. Paul makes that very clear in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. And be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, Paul says, even as God for Christ's sake, notice the verb tense here, hath already forgiven you. Today, we forgive others not to gain forgiveness, but as a show of our appreciation for the forgiveness that we already have. What a difference in what we have today in this dispensation of grace and what the Jews will be praying for in time future. Our final verse, verse 13, Matthew 6, 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Let's examine this one for a moment. The temptation spoken of here is testing. God never tempts with evil. In the original, you have a definite article in the statement. It says, deliver us from the evil. Christ had something particular in mind here as he taught this way of praying to his disciples. Some have even translated it, deliver us from the evil one. Most likely, it's a reference here to the Antichrist. Deliver us from the evil one who is coming in person to persecute us. That's the idea here. We can thank God that we don't have to pray this prayer today. Deliver us from the Antichrist. We're going to be delivered from this evil one before the tribulation ever begins, because we're going to be caught up to be with the Lord in the air. Then finally, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This final statement appears to be looking beyond the millennial kingdom, all the way to the eternal kingdom. Now, you have to remember that after the tribulation period, after the seven-year time of Jacob's trouble, God will set up his kingdom. He'll return to set up his kingdom through Christ for 1,000 years. And at the end of that 1,000 years, Scripture says there will be a little season when Satan is released. And then finally, the great white throne judgment in the eternal state, the new heavens and the new earth. And that will go on forever and ever, time without end. Now, I believe this last part of the prayer, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever, goes right beyond the thousand-year millennial reign that Israel expected, goes right beyond that millennium all the way to the eternal kingdom. Why do I say that? First of all, remember who is being addressed in this prayer. Our Father. Now look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 24. Then cometh the end, when he, meaning Christ, shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. That's what Christ is going to do, by the way, during that thousand-year millennial reign. He's going to rule with a rod of iron. He's going to put down all rule and all authority and all power that is contrary to his own. 1 Corinthians 15, 25 goes on to say, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he hath put all things under his feet, but when he saith all things are put under him, meaning Christ, it is manifest that he, meaning God, is accepted, God which did put all things under Christ. Verse 25 tells us the outcome. Verse 28, rather, tells us the outcome. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, unto Christ, then shall the Son, meaning Jesus Christ, also himself be subject unto him, meaning God, that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Let's wrap it up with a chronology here. Follow me through with this. At the end of the millennium, Christ turns the kingdom over to the Father. Now, he doesn't do that because the Father is any greater than he is. They are both God, God the Father, God the Son, right along with God the Holy Spirit. Christ turns the kingdom over to the Father because even within the Godhead, there are channels of authority. And ultimately, God the Father is the chief executive officer within the Godhead. You see, there's headship here. This issue of headship is very important. Christ turns the kingdom over to the head, to God the Father. At the end of the millennium, when Christ turns the kingdom over to the Father, is what this last statement in the prayer is referring to. For thine, our Father's, is the kingdom, Israel will be saying, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. One final passage is so similar to this final statement that we should not overlook it. King David of old recognized this truth, even when he was reigning as king of Israel. I want you to notice this, and notice the similarity to the disciples' prayer. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 10. Wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation, and David said, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory. Sound familiar? And the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Do you see the disciples' prayer sitting right there in the book of Chronicles? You see, the principle has been there all along. Someday, God the Father will rule over everything. He does today, in a sense. But in that day, all those enemies will be put aside and put away, and God the Father will have complete, total, and full control as the recognized sovereign head of the universe. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Will be the way to pray in that day. Then he says, Amen, or simply, so be it. And that's the true meaning of the disciples' prayer, a prayer to be offered as Israel faces the tribulation wrath of Satan. It's even more beautiful when it's understood within the context for which it was given. Prayer, you see, is truly a dispensational thing. It's not only to be discreet and not using vain repetition, but the prayer of faith is dispensational. The prayer is dispensational, I should say. The prayer of faith, one aspect of prayer, a taste of the kingdom in time past. The prayer of faith, a taste of the kingdom in time past. The prayer of peace for this present age we're living in, the dispensation of the grace of God, the prayer that provides peace for us in the midst of our turmoil. And then we see the disciples' prayer, a prayer for the tribulation saints.